Your Excellency, thank you very much for this opportunity to have this interview with you. I would like first to congratulate you for the last election. We hope all the best for you all the time. Actually, I believe it's a good opportunity either for the Egyptian audience to listen from you directly, and it's a good opportunity for you as well just to get a direct conversation, direct talk to the Egyptian people. I will start with the relation between Ethiopia and Egypt. How do you evaluate the relation, the level of cooperation between the two countries at this time?
Well, the relation between Egypt and Ethiopia is like a very old marriage with no possibility of divorce. Like all old marriages with no possibility of divorce, it has its ups and downs, but it is very solid. And it is of long standing.
Even with these downs, which you mentioned already now, it will continue. It will not affect this level of relation, you mean?
As I told you, there is no possibility of divorce between Egypt and Ethiopia.
If we talk about the level of cooperation and economic level, are you satisfied with what we have this time, these days?
In general, there has been a very significant improvement in the flow of trade and investment between Egypt and Ethiopia. This is a major improvement, but I think there is a lot of room for additional improvement.
Which rules we can cooperate together? Where we can have this higher level of cooperation?
In terms of trade, there are goods that Egypt produces that we need: chemical products, medical medicinal products. And so on, that we should be able to import more. There are products, particularly agricultural products like meat, that Ethiopia produces that Egypt could import more. Mm-hmm. So in terms of trade, I think there's a bigger opportunity. But I have to state that there has been very significant improvement both in trade and investment in the past few years.
Are Egyptian investors and businessmen, are they welcome here in Ethiopia?
They are, and they are already operating in Ethiopia. A number of them are already operating in Ethiopia.
Is there any sort of facilities you give for the non-Ethiopian investors, I mean for the outside investment?
Yes, there are a number of incentives given to foreign investors, and Egyptian investors will also be benefiting from these incentives that are given to foreign investors, like tax incentives, like access to land, and so on.
Well, now I would like to talk with you about the main issue, which is appear now between Egypt and Ethiopia, and it's about the Nile and this agreement which has been signed last couple of months ago. I would like to listen, and I think that the Egyptian people would like to listen from you, your vision about this issue. How do you find, how can we find a solution for this issue?
The first thing we have to recognize is that the utilization of the Nile water is not a zero-sum game. It doesn't mean that if the upper riparian countries benefit, Egypt and Sudan should lose. It doesn't mean that if Egypt and Sudan benefit, the upper riparian countries should lose. There is a win-win alternative. And the only solution to the Nile is a win-win solution. And it's not difficult to find a win-win solution. The Nile water can be used for two purposes. First purpose is the generation of electricity. The second purpose is for irrigation. In terms of utilization for electricity, no amount of dams built in the upper riparian countries will hurt Egypt or Sudan. On the contrary, if dams are built in Ethiopia, Egypt and Sudan will benefit. First, the siltation on the dams that you have in Egypt and Sudan will be removed. The Roseris Dam in Sudan has been silted to a maximum extent, so now it's become more or less useless. But if there were dams in Ethiopia, the silt would be in Ethiopia, and Sudan would get water without the soil. and therefore siltation would stop. The same thing, siltation would stop also on the Aswan Dam. So if dams are built in Ethiopia, siltation would be reduced in Sudan and Egypt. If dams are built in Ethiopia, the flow of the Nile will not vary throughout the year. It will be consistent.
Mm-hmm.
There will not be flooding in the summer, and there will not be shortage of water during the dry season. The flow of the water will be regulated throughout the year. And this will be to the benefit of Egypt and Sudan. If power, electricity is generated in Ethiopia, Sudan and Egypt can buy cheap electricity from Ethiopia. With regards to irrigation, irrigation is the only project that subtracts water. Power generation does not subtract water. In fact, in the case of Ethiopia, if you build dams in Ethiopia, because the surface of the lakes that will be built in Ethiopia will be small, because it will be deep.
Yeah.
And because this is highland, evaporation is slow.
It's falling down, not just running.
Yeah. Evaporation is low.
Yeah.
Which means if dams are built in Ethiopia, the total flow of the Nile will increase by 3 billion cubic meters of water. So the only thing which reduces water is irrigation. Now, irrigation in Ethiopia and irrigation in the upper riparian countries is very limited.
Mm-hmm.
It is very limited because the irrigable land in Ethiopia and the irrigable land in the upper riparian countries is very small. Only Sudan has unlimited irrigable land. Even Egypt has limited irrigable land.
Mm-hmm.
So if we were to improve the efficiency of the irrigation projects in the upper riparian countries and in the lower riparian countries, we could carry out all the necessary irrigation projects in Ethiopia, Uganda, and so on, without in any way damaging Egypt and Sudan. All we need is to improve the efficiency of the irrigation by 10%, and that will be more than enough.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, the win-win solution is there, and it is very simple.
Did you explain that to the Egyptians, to the Sudanese? Did you explain this your vision about this win-win solution in this by this words?
I have personally repeatedly said, there is only one solution to the Nile problem, and that solution is a win-win solution. If anybody loses, then there is no solution. If Egypt and Sudan lose, there is no solution. If Ethiopia, Uganda, and others lose, there is no solution.
Yeah.
However, we have now on the table
a
solution which addresses all of these problems because it is a win-win solution. And we have said this many times to our friends in Egypt and Sudan.
So why did you insist for this signature, for signing on this agreement on Entebbe before reaching to the point which every part is convinced with this win-win solution?
Because we reached a stage where Sudan and Egypt were insisting that the other seven countries accept the agreements of 1929
mm-hmm.
and 1959. Now, if we take the agreement of 1959, it says that all the water of the Nile will be distributed between Egypt and Sudan. There is nothing left for the other countries. This is not a win-win concept.
Mm-hmm.
And Sudan and Egypt were insisting that we accept the 1959 agreement. The Ethiopian government in 1959 rejected this agreement
mm-hmm.
because it excluded Ethiopia. Ethiopia is the source of 85% of the water.
That's right.
And the 1959 agreement gives zero liter of water to Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
Now this is not a win-win alternative. And Egypt and Sudan were insisting
mm-hmm.
that Ethiopia and the others accept this agreement. What we were saying is, let's forget about this agreement. Let's design a new agreement that protects the interests of Egypt and Sudan at the same time as protecting the interests of the Ethiopia, Uganda, and the others. And there was no flexibility with regards to the position of some of the officials of Egypt and Sudan. We waited for 10 years negotiating this issue. So after 10 years, the seven countries felt we need